I'm Jamal Thomas. Welcome to the Progressive Soapbox. So guys, I wanted to answer some viewer questions, actually. My subscriber count has jumped significantly over the past few weeks. And I think sometimes people have a hard time figuring me out. Like, there would be like a right winger who would be like, "Oh, right, this guy is awesome. I agree with everything he says." Then they would see another video and be like, "This guy's a damn communist." Or there will be Democrats, and at times Democrats are like, yeah, that's right, that's awesome, that sounds great. And at other times, one woman was like, this guy's a troll. Look, my biases are straightforward. They're pretty simple, actually. My bias is towards life. It's towards people. That's it. That's where it begins and ends. I believe we have a responsibility to one another. I believe we have a responsibility to take care of each other. And things that interfere with that, things that attack that, things that try to undercut that, I am absolutely against. This is no association with party at all. This is no affiliation with party. I could give two shits about a party. If your party is doing something that cuts against those interests or cuts against life, if you're doing something that's duplicitous, if you're doing something that's completely political without any sense of earnestness or integrity associated with it, I'm calling you out. It's that simple. That's where it begins and ends for me. It's not that complicated to me. Are you doing something that's crisscrossing the things that you espouse? If you're doing something that's crossing the things that you espouse, I'm going to call you out on those things. Whether that's Trump, whether that's Obama, whether it's Hillary, whether it's Rachel Maddow, it doesn't matter who it is. Hell, whether it's me, everybody's susceptible to being called out on it. So, that's my bias. That's my view, that's my lens. When I'm making an argument, when I'm making a point, that's the position into which I'm attacking somebody on. That's the beginning and end of it. Any particular person who's watching my video, whether it's a conservative, whether it's a Democrat, even though that's my lens, the information I'm going to interact with fairly. There are going to be things that Trump does that I'm going to think is pretty good. There are going to be things he does I'm going to think is absolutely ghastly. It doesn't bother me one iota to say, "Oh, I like this." It doesn't bother me one iota to say, "I greatly dislike this." And depending upon the severity of what it is, yeah, I'm probably going to lose my shit sometimes. But I'll always be earnest in getting it across. And my hope is that with a certain amount of videos backing up this perspective, backing up this position, or the positions that I take, that people who wouldn't typically agree with me, I'm hoping to bring those people along. I'm actually hoping those people say, "You know what? This guy has actually been pretty fair and straightforward in the way he's addressed these topics. I don't agree with him on everything. I think he's too far to the left on some stuff. But what are you saying?" He's presenting information, he's presenting evidence to back up his points. That's all I can hope for. That's all I can try to accomplish. And that's my goal at this point. So the second one, someone asked me, why don't I like Donald Trump? This one is funny to me. I don't like Donald Trump because Donald Trump is a liar. And he completely works at cross purposes with the thing I just laid out. Take, for instance, this budget. This budget is going to slash things that are absolutely important. So things like the EPA. You can like Trump and still want clean air and clean water. I don't understand why those two things are in conflict with one another. Cutting the Coast Guard is just weird and ridiculous. He was on the campaign trail. He over and over again said, "I'm going to get health care and it's going to be for everybody. It's going to be awesome." Well, he's cutting healthcare. It's not going to be for everybody. They're going to lose like 20-some million people off of healthcare. Now, if you're being consistent and honest, that's a lie. If he's saying he's going to drain the swamp, and he turns around and puts in people who are like Betsy DeVos and all these other people who, for the most part, are going to rape the systems and rape the company, the positions that they're in. Betsy DeVos is going to give a ton of money to these private schools and all this other garbage. Tillerson is essentially just functioning as an oil company arm. Even though he went after Hillary Clinton for her ties to Wall Street and all this other stuff, When Trump got in office, he did the exact same thing, putting those people in those positions, in addition to the billionaire who's backing his campaign. The people who donated millions of dollars to him, he cut out the middleman and just put those people directly into those positions. Now, do I think Hillary Clinton would have been different? I think she would have been different in a level of degrees, meaning Hillary Clinton was also going to put people in those positions that would have allowed her to essentially take on a pro-corporate, pro-globalist position, a platform. That's true. That's true. And Trump is doing this stuff. It's purely kleptocratic. But I'm consistent enough to realize that the difference between those two is only going to be a certain degree of margins. I take issue with both in that case. I don't want anybody raping my government in that sense. I don't want anybody taking money from sources that actually need that money. Where, look, how you take care of the least of the people in your particular society is the mark of that society. Let's keep that shit real. If we're going to spend 50-some billion dollars extra, we already spent like $1 trillion on the military. We're raising that amount of money to like $50 billion more. Who's the enemy? Who's the enemy? Who's the person we need to spend $1 trillion on to go after? If you're honest with yourself, the reason why we're spending all this money on military is because our main export is weapons. It's arms. We believe in this weird and immoral way that spending all this money on military and armaments and all this other stuff allows for jobs. But if you're creating that stuff, you're going to use that stuff. Come on, let's be honest. When we're out there dropping bombs, what? Obama dropped like 20-some thousand bombs last year. I remember there was a report that came out that they dropped so many bombs that they started to run out of bombs. We can't get water to the people of Flint. I mean, clean water to the people of Flint. But we have billions of dollars to spend on military. We can't get schools to people who need it. We can't get healthcare to the people that need it. We have crumbling infrastructure. Literally, we have like D and F grades all across the United States in regard to infrastructure. But we can spend $1 trillion murdering other people around the globe. Come on. Come on, be honest. Be honest. Be consistent in the things that you're saying. I'm not having to go at you for supporting Trump. I'm having to go at you for supporting policies that are working across purposes with you, with your life, your community. And I hear a lot of people talk about like welfare and all this other stuff. And they make this association with Obama and welfare. And I can't help but think that some of this is in regards to race. Because I don't remember this critique on Bill Clinton. Most of the people on welfare are white, by a large degree. Poverty among blacks is more desperate, that's true. But the people who are using those welfare, those services, those handouts, are white. The people who voted for Trump were predominantly white. And the people who Trump is going to hurt with the policies that he's pushing for are going to be predominantly white. I understand the perspectives that people have who are supporting Trump. But understand, you're hurting yourself more than anybody else. So somebody asked about American exceptionalism. I thought this was an interesting question. After World War II, the United States did something that was pretty goddamn amazing. We converted all of the industrial might in this country to war effort. We were able to put full-fledged military armaments, like an entire, I don't know what they call it, I don't know what's the word for it, but essentially two massive forces on different parts of the globe attacking for Japan and for Germany, in addition to being essentially the arm of the resistance in regards to the war itself. That was an amazing feat. That was an absolutely amazing feat. We've got our industrial base, but at that time, those things had been converted over to create military equipment, and we did an amazing job of producing that equipment, and in doing so, became somewhat of a superpower. Now, you have to understand, though, Europe was demolished. Within, I think, like 20 years, Europe had two massive wars. The last one, it killed like 50 million people. The one before that, I think it was like 10 or 20 million people that died. We were exceptional because we had no competition at that point. We had free reign. America, for the most part, was intact. They didn't hit us on home soil, with the exception of the Pearl Harbor. we were intact. Our competition was not. You can look pretty damn exceptional when you're not really being compared to anybody. Beyond that, though, also the things that we say about ourselves, the illusions that we have about ourselves, those are illusions. You gotta understand that there's no there to it. It's every country has things about themselves that they kind of blow up, that they make themselves feel better about themselves, that gives this image. Like, for instance, have you noticed that when we talk about military engagement, anything that the United States does, by definition, is right, because the United States, for the most part, based on media, is taking the position for the right reasons. It's never predicated that the United States is doing something for craven or mischievous reasons. It's always taken as, well, we're doing something, and we may fuck up, but we're doing it for the right reasons. Well, that's a childish view of things. But that is the view that the media, for the most part, takes. It's a reflection that gets reflected back to ourselves. It makes these people feel better about themselves. But you have to ask the question, exceptional in what way? Like, what way? What's the way in which we are exceptional? Politicians say this stuff. Politicians say this stuff because it's how they get votes. It's easier to have a conversation with you if I'm blowing smoke in your ass and making you feel better about yourself. If I'm having an honest conversation with you of saying, yeah, man, our schools are crumbling pretty bad. Our infrastructure is horrid. We have income inequality that's mind-blowing. I mean, the level of income inequality was only matched, and I believe we exceeded the levels just before the Great Depression. Even in the Obama administration, a Democratic administration who runs on this idea of progressivism, 95% of the gains went to the top 1%. The unemployment figure that we have is a completely fictitious number. We lie to ourselves. We lie to ourselves. We have illusions about ourselves. Exceptionalism is one of those illusions. Every country that was somewhat of a superpower, whether it was Britain, whether it was Rome, considered themselves to be indispensable. None of those countries were, in fact, indispensable. No country has a right to exist. Those countries are either going to be there or not. But a right to exist is if there is some fundamental God-given reason for your existence, and that your existence in somehow is a fulcrum to the rest of the world. That's an illusion. That doesn't exist. There is no American exceptionalism. We're just people. We're no different than the people anywhere else. That's what it boils down to. We may be fatter. We may be a little bit dumber. We may be more specific to our particular country and less concerned with the rest of the world. But if we're being honest, we're just people. That's it. No more, no less, no better, no worse. Flawed crackpots. People. So, the Loretta Lynch video, the Obama thing. I gotta be honest, this one was a little weird to me. I didn't quite know how to feel about it. There were like 10,000 views for the video for Loretta Lynch. And I'm making reference to the video where she came out batshit crazy, like losing her shit on the camera, acting like she was fighting off a mob or something, or that talking about we have to bleed and we have to die and all, just crazy, crazy stuff. My take on the video, my analysis of the video, boils down to this woman is being crazy. This woman doesn't want to have an honest reason for why the Democrats lost that election, and they want to blow up any and everything they can rather than have that conversation. They've decided, they made a concerted decision, a conscious decision, that the way to deal with the Trump administration is to essentially co-opt the movements that are resisting that administration. Meaning, stand in front of a crowd and say, we are together. Are we? We are backing you up. We have to fight in this case. We have to bleed and die. We have to. They're using all this flowery language about our values to try to make a distinction between Trump and them. The distinctions that they create are never really clear. It's always made in language that allow the person to inject themselves into it. If you're gay, black, Hispanic, Muslim, whatever, they give you enough buzzwords and enough openness where you can invest yourself into whatever they're saying, allowing you to become part of their movement, or other way around, allowing them to become part of your movement, to give the appearance that they are somehow on your side, in your corner. They're not. They're not at all. That's why I joked the video. I understood how ridiculous the video was, and I completely understood just the shallow and shamelessness of it. Understand, though, me pointing that out, I'm being specific to the thing that I'm analyzing. Some of the comments on that video were atrocious. I had this feeling like, I don't agree with these people. Like, it was a lot of things that people were saying that I did agree with. There were a lot of things that people said that I didn't quite agree with, but I understood where they were coming from. Some of the stuff, not so much. And it created this, weirdness of integrity, this strange aspect of trying to deal with questions earnestly and honestly, that sometimes you're going to take a position that people who you completely disagree with will agree with. The reason they're agreeing with you is not the same reason that you yourself are making, but they're agreeing with you because they dislike the person who you yourself are going after. This is not necessarily bad in and of itself, but it does create this kind of meta-awareness, this narrative of, I'm taking this position and these people are joining in on this particular position, and they're being pretty hateful in regards to attacking this woman. My attack was very specific to what it was, and it was detailed and information-based. Their attack is based on something else. Look, I gotta be honest, that makes it somewhat difficult. And I saw that video and my thought was, oh man, it's not that I disliked the video, but the video was just fine. It's just some of the commentary on it made me feel like this isn't the tone and the tenor that I was going after. I was trying to point out how ridiculous this woman was being. And in doing so, a lot of people did recognize the ridiculousness of it, but a lot of them added their own spin on it that wasn't based in reality at all. And some of it was just hateful. So, yes, taking in a position based on integrity is just right. But it doesn't necessarily make it easy when some of the people who agree with you, when you take those positions, are not coming from a place of integrity. They're coming from a place of hate or a place of just batshit craziness. I kind of resolved into just saying, well, it is what it is. There are going to be situations where it can't affect my take. Meaning, who agrees with me or not has nothing necessarily to do with how I address a particular issue. I just have to get over it. I have to just accept that there are going to be cases where I go after somebody and there are going to be people who agree with me who I don't necessarily agree with. There are going to be cases where I defend somebody, again, that I may not necessarily agree with. There have been cases where I defended Donald Trump. Because I feel like if I'm going to have any integrity whatsoever in regards to making a case and I'm bringing people over to my side, I have to be consistent and I have to be earnest and honest in the way I present information and the positions I take based on that information. That's just a fundamental core belief to me. I don't think we get past anything. I don't think we get past this partisanship. I don't think we get past, get beyond this basic, ridiculous politics without first and a fundamental level of integrity, of honesty. You can disagree with me all you want in many things, but at the very least, accept the fact that I'm making the case and that case is being earnest, and you can look over the 200-some videos that I created to show that case is being earnest. I find that to be important. So, so this is an interesting one. I've made the case before that I have a few right-wingers on my site. One of the gentlemen, he comes across as a pretty decent guy. He scares the shit out of me sometimes in the things that he says. But we've had some pretty decent substantive conversations. One of the conversations that he made was essentially saying, I understand your perspective on a lot of this stuff, but you have to accept that if you're going to put forth a policy that he would consider socialist, or if you're going to advocate a particular position that he would consider socialist, and maybe it is, that ultimately you're creating an authoritarian situation where you are taking something from somebody to give to somebody else. In this case, he's talking about, for the most part, cash. If you're raising taxes or whatever, and you're essentially saying, I'm going to tax this particular demographic heavily, and give services and everything else to the rest of the population, that for the most part, you're using government to do that particular thing. I find this to be an interesting conversation because it does get into this idea of what's the point of money? In fact, it gets into two ideas, both of which are somewhat philosophical, but both of which are also somewhat practical and true. We were born on this planet with nothing. None of us owned a piece of dirt. None of us owned any resource whatsoever. The resources that we acquired, for the most part, were taken from somebody else. Meaning, the civilizations that we created were done so through blood and pain all the world over. Taking this land from the Native Americans, we committed genocide. Building up this capital, this city, this country, we used slave labor that allowed a huge lead in regard to capital to be created by one group of the population, with the other group of the population being in desperate poverty. The resources of this world, they were freely given to everybody. Groups, individual within that society, took those resources and used them for their own ends and shielded them from other people. They called it private property, and they created laws and rules to govern why they should be able to have certain resources. Resources that, again, nobody gave them. Ultimately, in the beginning, it had to be taken. So if you're going to make the case to me that, well, you're taking something from somebody else, the original, the origin of that stuff, just by virtue of what it is, just virtue of where it comes from, where our resources come from, it was taken from somebody in the first place. Also, from a second standpoint, money. Money is not indistinguishable from the state. You must understand this. This is a key point. Money is a function of the state. It's not separate and distinct from the state. Meaning, if you're going to have a society, and you're going to say, this particular society has something of value, some kind of monetary denomination, something of cash, the state is the one that legalizes that. The state is the one who says, this is the currency. This is the thing that we're going to use for commerce and bargaining and whatever else. That's the state. Without the state, that money doesn't exist. Meaning, if you're going to have a situation of having cash, the state has to predate that cash. It has to predate that wealth. It has to predate all of that stuff. Money is a function of the state, not the other way around. The whole point is not to acquire money. The whole point is to use money to essentially distribute resources throughout a particular society, throughout a particular community. This stuff is based, for the most part, on scarcity. This idea that there are not enough resources to go around, and so you need something that could constrain the usage of a particular resource. The goal is not for somebody to have $1 billion. That's not the goal. That's not the goal at all. Someone may tweak and work the system that way to get that much money, and they may be able to accrue wealth in that way. But understand, the point is to be able to distribute those resources evenly and fairly throughout the country. There should never be a situation where you have somebody who's lying on the street hungry and somebody else's multiple houses and $1 billion. When you're watching Hunger Games, TV, movies, art, has this beautiful way of getting across something from a third-person perspective that takes you out of it, that takes the emotional disconnectedness to a particular situation and extract you out of it a little bit to give you some distance and context. When they're showing the situation of most of the districts being absolutely hungry, absolutely starving, and they have food that would allow you to throw up so you can eat more food on top of it, that is our society. That is absolutely our society. We have, most of the world lives off of like $2 a day. Literally. When people are making this argument on how awesome capitalism is, they're really only talking about their own situation. The rest of the world can't live like that because there's not enough resources for the rest of the world to live that way. The fact that you have a billionaire, the fact that you have somebody with millions of dollars, the fact that you have somebody with multiple houses, that only happens if you have somebody who does not have those things, who's destitute, who's broke, who's poor. We do not have infinite resources. Meaning that if somebody is hoarding, if you have 100 slices of pizza and somebody takes 99, for that person to get those 99 slices, somebody else is going desperately hungry. So how do I justify it? I justify it because the point of money is not to accumulate. The point of money is to circulate in society to get people the resources that they need. Money is a function of the state, not the other way around. I justify it, but making the point, this is, A, you didn't get those resources. Those resources were taken and handed to you at some point. And B, the job, the point, is to build the society. If there are people hungry in that society, if the infrastructure is crumbling in that society, however you want to see fit, we make an investment in the people in this particular country, whether it's school, healthcare, whatever else. There are going to be some investments that go gangbusters, and somebody is going to create a company that makes a huge amount of money. It was an investment. That person should be able to pay back on that investment. Up to this point, these people find any and every way whatsoever to avoid paying back for the services, for the people who bought their product, for the people who built their product, the infrastructure, the things, the police department, the fire department, the things that allow their company to prosper and to earn capital. Those things are generated by the society itself. And if that person is going to function in our society, if that person is going to reap the resources of the people, allow those people to buy their product, if they're going to use the land, the water, the electricity, the fire department, the police station, all these things, if they're going to use those things, then based upon their means, yeah, they should be taxed on it. They should be taxed heavily on it, particularly when it needs to pay for the resources for the rest of society. And also, you got to also understand, this isn't purely self-interest. It's also purely to keep the economy going. Capitalism, unrestrained, eats itself. It completely eats itself. Think about it. You have a situation where a company's vested interest is to accrue as much profit as possible. That's the capitalistic model. And accruing as much cap as possible, how do you do that? You either cut down on the supplies itself, meaning I need to buy things for less. I either need to sell things for more, and I need to cut down the cost of creating that particular product. Cutting down the cost of that product means labor. I either need to automate that process, I need to ship that job overseas, or I need to pay that person less. That's how I, myself, am going to make more money in this deal. But right there is a problem. If you're eliminating that worker can no longer buy the goods that you're producing. If you're cutting the salary, the ability of that person to buy the goods that you're producing also has gone down. The moment that you automate that process, yes, you have a computer or robot doing that job, but that robot is not buying your supplies. The person who you got rid of was going to buy your supplies. At a certain point, you will reach the level where you have so many people who are unemployed, so many people who don't have the money, that those people can't keep the economy going because those people don't have money to keep the economy going. The goods and services that the people have been selling, and the people are trying to get out, that these capitalists are making all this money off, comes to a halt. Not because people don't want their products, more so because people can't afford their products. Essentially, in being greedy, they're essentially killing off their own business model. Capitalism eats itself. FDR, when he was passing all those bills and for the New Deal, he wasn't doing it out of the kindness of his heart. I mean, maybe on some degree, but a lot of this had to do with, oh my God, we're going to lose capitalism because of the excesses of capitalism, and we need to do something to essentially hold off these unionists, these socialists, these communists, these groups that were in the United States at that time that was on Roosevelt's ass, that was perfectly willing and perfectly able to convert this country from a capitalistic model to a socialist model. He did what he had to do to preserve capitalism. I'm making a point that capitalism needs to be managed and it needs to be balanced. Otherwise, it is going to eat itself. You thought the crash in 2008 was bad. Wait till you see the next one. We're, what, $17 trillion in debt. A lot of the money that we paid out was giving the bank all of this money to prop up the economy. You're not going to have that money the next time this thing crashes. You're not going to have it. You're not going to be able to go to that well. That next crash is going to be abysmal and is going to hurt a lot of people. And part of the reason it's going to hurt a lot of people has to do with the income, the economics, the system itself, this Ponzi scheme of the system. it will eat itself at some point. So, yeah, I'll stop there. Guys, just on a side note, I really want to thank you guys for subscribing to the channel. I started this channel and my feeling was I kind of want some honesty. I want people to present stories, or at the very least do stories and intellectually engage the story honestly. Give insights into the story. Give your thinking process. Make fun of it at times. Be serious about it at other times. Be a person. Be a goddamn human being. Flawed and all, but be a person when you're presenting the stories. For the most part, I think I've been able to accomplish this. And ultimately, I do want to thank you guys for joining the channel. I'm not always going to say things that you like. I'm not even going to always say things that you agree with. But I will be able to hold my point, and I will be able to back up whatever I'm saying with a particular argument. And the time you catch me when I can't back it up with an argument, all things being equal, I will probably just say, you're right. My bad. So, thanks again, guys. Again, anytime you see a video, feel free to like the content, feel free to comment. I read the comment sections, by the way. I respond to a lot of the comments, particularly the comments that I think are honest and well thought out and well reasoned. Particularly if it's something that I may have messed up on or misspoke or said wrong, I definitely engage the comment because I kind of want to be accurate in the things that I say. So, thank you very much for joining this channel, and thank you very much for staying with me in this channel. If you guys ever have suggestions or, hell, for that matter, critiques or ideas on how to make the channel better, I am going to get a mic. I've gotten that a few times. I am going to get a mic. But yeah, guys, feel free to comment. Feel free to share these videos. Feel free to subscribe. Feel free to like them. So, thanks, everybody.